long as there's at least one guy out there that really appreciates it, it's not going to die. And this stuff's going to be around longer than you and I are around. And all we can really do is do our best to preserve what's here and not destroy it, you know, and try to keep it moving. And hopefully what I'm doing is putting my own spin on it, and people will look back 30 years from now and say, you know, that guy did a good job with what he had, you know, and that's really all I can hope for. My name is Brian Bass, and we're in Dallas, Texas, in Deep Ellum, technically. Deep Ellum is kind of the artsy, funky part of Dallas, and that's where my shop is. Been in this shop now since 2004, right at the tail end of 2004. I primarily am geared up here to do early forward hot rods. And so a hot rod can be lots of things. It's evolved through the years, but to me, a hot rod, they started out in the late 30s, early 40s, running dry lakes, running on the street, running then a drag strip, the late 40s, early 50s. And what I'm set up to do here is build cars that emulate that look, those cars that were built back then. So the parts that are hanging on the walls or stacked around me, all parts necessary to build those type of cars. So I've got a flathead here, a Chrysler Hemi there. You know, those are the things I tend to gravitate towards those parts, because I know, you know, it's not just a Hemi to me. That's a car, that's an engine that goes in this Willis over here. That flathead's not just a flathead to me. That's an engine that goes in the 32.5 when it's out in the trailer, you know. So, you know, there's everything in here has a specific purpose, and that's to build cars that look like they came out of a magazine page from the early 50s. I can look at a 32 Ford coupe and say, okay, I think this is really a really bitchin' early 60s style car. Or I may look at the next 32 Ford coupe and say, you know what, this thing needs to be chopped, needs to have a track nose, needs to be dry lake style, you know. And sometimes it's either the owner of the car that speaks to you, you know, like this guy really should have this kind of car, or it's the car itself, you know. Like, I try to let the car, I know it sounds goofy, but I try to let the car tell me what it wants. And sometimes it's just a small hint, you know, and after you do this for a while, you kind of pick up on it. It's like, okay, this car, the guy that had this car back in 1958, he put this sticker on the window because he thought he was going to build this kind of car. And it'd be kind of cool to do that, you know, finish this guy's vision and take the car where it needs to go. So, you know, it's hard to say any one car needs to be a specific style, you know, set up for this, set up for that. There are rules, and they're made to be broken sometimes, but, you know, the car, I try to let the car tell me what it wants, unless I have a specific purpose for it, like my Model T back there. When I got it, I didn't know what I was going to do with it, and then it evolved into what it is now. A lot of times when you look at a car, you think, well, I would like to build this crazy 60s car out of this car, but really this may be, I don't have the right part for this, and maybe that part costs $10,000, you know, so it may come down to where you have to kind of like say, you're not really going to cut corners, but you have to kind of cull what your expectations are for the car. And a lot of times that makes you even more creative. So sometimes that actually adds to the process. Let's say I can't afford that $10,000 blower, so I'm going to put four Strombergs on it. And well, if I'm going to put four Strombergs on it, that makes it more of a car from like the late 50s, you know. So rather than being a 60s car with a big blower, now I'm more towards the late 50s. And that will actually drive the next decision, which will be like wheels and tires, or how much to chop it, or what kind of interior, what steering wheel do you use, you know, even what gauges you use. All these things, to me, in my brain, lock up with each other. So when the tumblers fall into place, then that kind of starts determining what the car is going to be. And each one of those tumblers is a decision, you know, a decision about what part I can use, what part I can find, what part I can afford. If those things all line up, then maybe you'll have a really bitchin' car. If they were to all get kind of sideways, then maybe you have a really shitty car. But hopefully I've done enough research and learned enough about this, you know, just from doing it day to day, that the tumblers hit the right spots and we turn out a bitchin' car at the end. I've got to the point now where, like, I think about cars that I'm not going to touch for 5 years, you know, and I still have parts from starting to pile up. So when I get ready to build the car, everything is sitting here, and I only have to find a few things. And that's the thing about building a really traditional car in today's day and age. You can get on eBay and find parts, but sometimes it's not there. And you either have to have networking to know, you have your group of friends that you can call and say, hey, I really need this part. It's kind of like a linchpin of what's going to make this car. And then you can go and find it. And that's really nice to have. And the internet's good for that. Instagram, you know, all these things, we have these networking tools now that weren't available back in the day. But that's one way to do it. The other way to do it is just to have a big collection. And I tend to side on having a big collection because, you know, if you get to the point, like you said, if you get to the point you need this part, you actually have to have it. A lot of times you're going to pay through the nose for it. And me always being a budget builder, not having a large budget to work with, I always try to find that part for a little bit cheaper at a swap meet and just sit on it for a while, you know. And sometimes having all these parts around, it definitely is a godsend when it comes down to the point where you have to pay a bill and you don't have anything to do it, but you got that part sitting right there. You know you can sell in 5 minutes. So that's the thing. It's like, it's not all just junk sitting here. Not only is there a specific purpose for each one of these parts, there's also, it's a safety net at times, you know. There's times where you have to say, yeah, you know what, I'd love to keep this thing, but I'm going to sell it because it keeps me moving. history is a large part of what I do here on a day-to-day basis. But you have to know that if you go way outside the box, not everybody might like it, you know. You have, and especially when we're talking about a Model A or a 32 or a very traditional style car, it is okay to go outside the box and do your own thing. But you have to understand the history behind it. Okay, if I'm going to chop it 7 inches, why do I want to chop it 7 inches? Is it because I wanted it to be more aerodynamic? Is it because I wanted to make a statement? I mean, really, to me, you need to know the underlying reason for doing these things. And I had it's funny, I had a conversation about a guy that was wanting to put a 20-inch wheel on his truck. I was like, where did that 20-inch wheel idea come from? He's like, well, I just like that wheel. Well, I mean, why do you like that wheel? Why do you think people started using a 20-inch wheel on cars? He's like, well, I don't know. I was like, well, to me, when I see a 20-inch wheel, if I think in my historian brain, I think, well, that's because they needed a bigger brake rotor, bigger caliper to stop the car, so they need a larger diameter wheel, and that goes back to racing. And that's really where this comes from, is racing led to larger diameter wheels because they wanted bigger brakes, and to clear the bigger brakes, they had to have bigger wheels, and then that led to a different sort of tire, you know, so we have lower profile tires. And he's like, shut up, dude, I just want to buy a set of wheels. So, but I mean, still, I mean, if you start getting into this and you really learn the history behind it, you start looking at everything that way, and that really, to me, it affects your decisions on what you decide to do. So if I want to chop one of these cars 7 inches, I have a reason why, because I've researched these cars and know the ones that raced at Bonneville. I can probably tell you, an example of a car that was chopped 7 inches that raced at Bonneville in 1952, you know? So, you know, those things, to me, if you sit down and take the time to read old magazines, and that's the thing, is like, people ask, well, where do you get this knowledge from? Well, one is being around it and working with them. Two is just pick up old magazines and read them. Look at the pictures, you know, and they have text too. It's not just pictures. You actually can read the articles and learn things from them still today. You know, that information didn't die when the magazine went out of date. You know, that stuff is still relevant today if you're building this type of car. Building a car that's timeless has always been my goal. And when I say timeless, people think, well, you're building a time capsule. And that's not what I mean at all. What I mean by timeless is a car that will still look good. We'll let the train go by. This fucking train. Anyway, so to me, building a car that's timeless does not necessarily mean a car that's a time capsule. I mean, I think that you can build a car that's timeless with modern parts like an overdrive transmission or electronic fuel injection, all these things. But if the car is the right look, those things don't become an eyesore or something that jumps out at you. They become part of the car as a whole. And I see the Roaster Shop guys doing that. I see Trepanier, all these, you know, high-end shops. They're taking cars and they're taking cues from the past and building cars that I would call more timeless. And again, not time capsules, not like they're stuck in 1952, but they're building cars in 2017, 2018 that may have parts of those cars, but they're doing it in a way that where when you look back 30 years from now, you can say, yes, that car still, it stands the test of time. I grew up in the 80s. I was born in 77, and I went to car shows in the 80s in Waco, which is, doesn't sound like a hotbed of hot rodding, but there really was a lot of hot rodding there. There were actually people that were my age or a little older that were forming car clubs and building traditional hot rods and all this stuff in Southern California, and then it turned out to be across the country. When we actually got the internet and it started connecting people, we realized, I realized I wasn't alone. I wasn't the only one in the world that still liked traditional hot rods, and all these guys started, you know, putting events together and building these cars, and like car clubs like the Shifters or the Road Agents, all these car clubs from Southern California and even the East Coast and across the world started getting together and showing that, yes, the young people actually appreciate this stuff. And it's funny, I think that those car clubs of the late 90s, early 2000s kind of revolutionized hot rodding by bringing it back to where it started. All I can hope is that, you know, maybe I've made a positive impact just in some small way, if not like teaching someone how to do something, or showing them how I do it, but if nothing else, maybe showing people it's okay to try different things, you know, and you can build a traditional hot rod without sticking to those set of rules I talked about. You can break the rules from time to time as long as you know why you're breaking them, you know, and that's, if anything, maybe that's what I've contributed, like made people more accepting that traditional hot rods aren't necessarily in this tiny little box. They can make it be in a bigger box, you know. So I don't know that I'm directly responsible for anything, but if I am, that's great, you know, and that's my job here would be done, I guess, you know, I can just hang it up. Well, I never really set out to be a businessman. That's one thing that I've had a really rough time with, because I don't really even see myself as a businessman still, you know. I see myself as an artist, and that's, I know that's kind of pushing the boundaries of what an artist is too, because I mess with old dirty metal every day, but, you know, what we do is really a craft in an art form, and if you really stand back and look at it, that's exactly what it is. And that's not always something that jives with making money. This goes back to being a great business plan. It's really not, you know, it's more like I'm painting them a painting that might take me 2 years or whatever, you know, but when I'm done with it, it's a bitchin' painting. So, you know, maybe I won't get enough money to pay for those 2 years I took to paint it, but at least I had fun doing it. The fact that I love it so much, you know, I don't think you can really run me out of business, because I'll just keep doing it until, you know, until I have one dime left. You know, the money side of it, it matters to a certain extent, but it's not why I do it. I do it because I love building cars, you know, and I love making parts, and I just love being around hot rods, and driving them is really the best part for me, you know. So all those things together, they really are what drives me to keep doing it. And yes, I have a family, and fortunately they're understanding that I am an idiot that likes old cars, and I'm not always going to be, you know, buying the next best greatest thing, because, you know, building hot rods doesn't always pay well. But in the end, they understand that, and fortunately, you know, they haven't kicked me out yet.
They're doing it down in that song. Damn that funky soul.